Good morning and welcome to our service. It's the last Sunday before the season of Lent officially starts next week on Ash Wednesday. And it's also the last service that we will be pre-recording because thankfully we will be able to resume our in-person services from the 21st onwards. And so I invite you all very warmly to join us on that day. But for those of you who, for whatever reason, still prefer to stay at home and stay in the safety of your own four walls, we will be putting up that service as we did in October, November last year. From the 21st onwards, we will be recording the live service and then putting it up on YouTube. So let us celebrate the service now in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The watchword for this week, taken from the Gospel of Luke, already leads us into the season of Lent. From Luke 18, verse 31, "We are going up to Jerusalem, and everything that is written by the prophets about the Son of Man will be fulfilled." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can start the season of Lent now, where we follow the journey of your Son Jesus Christ all the way to the cross and then to that wonderful resurrection on Easter Sunday. As we go on this journey, help us to do so deliberately, and that we really just are able to meditate on the meaning of what that means for our lives. We pray this in your precious name. Amen. And we pray together with words from Psalm 31, selected verses. "In you, O Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness. Turn your ear to me. Come quickly to my rescue. Be my rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me. Since you are my rock and my fortress, for the sake of your name, lead and guide me. Free me from the trap that is set for me, for you are my refuge. Into your hands I commit my spirit. Redeem me, O Lord, the God of truth. But I trust in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God. My times are in your hands. Deliver me from my enemies and from those who pursue me. Let your face shine on your servant. Save me in your unfailing love. Amen."
Bow down, here I am to say that you're mine. reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 to 13. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship, that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Here ends the reading. Hallelujah.
To praise the wonders of your mighty
Gospel reading is taken from Mark chapter 8, verses 31 to 38. Glory be to you, O Lord. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." Then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels. Praise be to you, O Christ."
Let us now confess our faith in the triune God. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Why do we need a cross in the church? Why does the cross have to be so central in everything we do? Can we not just have a Christian faith without the cross? If we think of the cross as a visual image, we notice that the cross is literally everywhere in Christianity. In our building, it's on the wall, it's on the altar cloth, outside in the Garden of Remembrance. Some other churches are built in the shape of a cross. Many other Christian places also have crosses, cemeteries, or on hills overlooking towns, sometimes lit up. Those of you who know our beautiful Kailaga youth campsite on the south coast will know there's a big cross on the little knoll just towards the beach from the site. In Christian art, we see famous paintings of Christian artists time and time again, with the cross being a central image, or the crucifixion scene as a whole. Crosses to hang on walls in houses, or hospitals or other places. It's a very favorite confirmation present, a necklace with a cross in silver or gold. Our services are full of crosses. During the blessing, during the communion, the Apostles' Creed speaks clearly of the cross. Communion itself commemorates an event that happened just before the crucifixion and speaks of the sacrifice that Jesus has made on the cross. Baptism has the symbolic meaning of dying and being resurrected with Christ. And the sign of the cross on the forehead is part of every baptism I have ever seen. Everywhere we look in the Christian community, the cross is present. It's almost so ever-present that we don't always notice it until it is somewhere where we don't expect it. I remember many years ago, my father was in hospital in Cape Town. The main building of this hospital was a modern setup. For years, this hospital had already been run by one of the big private healthcare groups. I vaguely knew this used to be a church-run hospital owned by the Roman Catholic Church many years before. Now, the few remaining sisters who used to run the hospital are old and frail and in need of care themselves. Anyway, big was my surprise when I saw a crucifix hanging on the wall in the wardroom where my father was in. In this modern, otherwise completely clinical hospital, there was an old hand-carved crucifix on the wall. And for my father, this was a comfort. Yes, I may be in the best hands that modern medicine can offer, but also the reminder, I am under the care and protection of Jesus. Not so for the man lying in the bed next to my father. Several times he asked the nursing sisters to take it away. A crucifix has no business in a modern hospital, was his line. But the answer was always the same. I'm sorry, sir. This hospital may be run by XYZ Medical Group. I'm not going to say the name here now, of course. But the church is still the owner. And they insist that each room has a Bible and a crucifix. Let's explore the symbolism behind that. What happens if the cross gets in the way or is an irritation to someone? Now, I can understand why some people may be uncomfortable with the cross. It is, after all, the most brutal, dehumanizing way of killing someone that the Romans invented. Looking at the cross, we are, in a way, reminded of death every time that we look at it. On the surface, it represents failure, as if God's plan to save the nations failed at the hands of the mighty Roman Empire. It's not a nice sight, a body hanging there, dying. And yet, for Christians, it is the most important symbol ever, and also the symbol that, despite its horror, gives us hope. And I read to you from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 21 onwards. For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand miraculous signs and Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified. A stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to Gentiles, but to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. In some circles of the church in Europe, I've noticed a tendency that tries to shift focus away from the cross. Drawing a cross as a hand sign is seldom done in these circles. In some of the strange architecture of some of the modern church buildings that I saw in some cities, like Berlin, for example, the cross was still somehow there, but very much in the background and often designed in such a weird way into the architecture that you could hardly recognize it. Sermons about the cross of Jesus are not welcome in these circles. Sermons about Jesus' moral teachings, about caring for creation or about world peace, are much more popular. The idea that the cross is necessary is dismissed as a barbaric relic of an uncivilized, bloodthirsty past in human history. Even the communion liturgy gets changed. It's no longer the body of Christ given for you and the blood of Christ shed for you. Instead, some prefer to use the words, the bread of life given for you, or the cup of salvation for you. Now, not that those words are wrong per se, but to me it appears a bit sanitized. Maybe the original was judged as not suitable for sensitive viewers. But let's backtrack 2,000 years. Even before the events actually happened, Jesus' disciples were also not too comfortable with the idea. We just heard in the gospel reading, Peter and the other disciples also couldn't understand why the cross was necessary. But Jesus rebuked them strongly. Now, on one level, I can understand them, both the modern Europeans and the disciples 2,000 years ago. Who wants to be constantly reminded of brutality and murder, suffering and death, when you want to hear a message of hope in the church? But are we not maybe missing something? Is it not maybe right there in the midst of this hopeless image of the Savior on the cross that we find hope as Christians? Who wants to follow a teacher who is on a suicide mission? But was that really all that Jesus wanted to achieve? A massive public spectacle of planned suicide? No matter how hard we try, the cross cannot be taken out of the message of the gospel. It becomes hollow, without meaning, without the cross. His teaching about his heavenly Father, of the kingdom of God, of eternal life, of forgiveness of sins, only makes sense when we see the cross. What is the message of the cross? What is its meaning? In one word, love. The love of a heavenly Father who is willing to sacrifice his most treasured possession, his only Son. The love of our Savior, Jesus, who was willing to go this path, even if it meant carrying the sin of the world. And by doing this, Jesus immersed himself in the suffering of humanity. By doing this, he experienced all the suffering that any human has ever suffered. He understands our hardships better than anyone, all because of love. Now, the New Testament and the Greek language has a special word for this kind of love. It's called agape. Agape love is unconditional love. When we say God is love, then we mean this unconditional agape love. The epistle reading we heard earlier, that famous passage from 1 Corinthians, uses the same word, agape. Will you allow me a little wordplay for a moment? We just spoke about God is love. And we could also say Jesus is love because Jesus is God. So let's try something with this text from 1 Corinthians 13. Everywhere where the word love, which is agape, is written, I will replace the word with Jesus. Are you with me? Let's try that. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have Jesus, I am a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have Jesus, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have Jesus, I have gained nothing. Jesus is patient. Jesus is kind. Jesus does not envy. He does not boast. He is not proud. Jesus does not dishonor others. Jesus is not self-seeking. He is not easily angered. He keeps no record of wrongs. Jesus does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. Jesus always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Jesus never fails. Jesus is love, and his perfect agape love can be seen on the cross. And that is why we will join the Apostle Paul and continue to proclaim the cross of Christ wherever we can, because it is at the cross where we can most clearly see the love of God, because God is love. Let the cross be a stumbling block or foolishness to whoever wants to get offended by it. To us, it is a monument of love, the greatest love that anyone has ever shown. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we pray for our congregation. We pray that even in this time when fellowship is difficult and challenging, we pray that you may help us to reach out to each other in whatever way is possible. Lord, we pray for your blessing and your protection over us as we start the in-person services again. We pray for your blessing and your wisdom at the AGM on the 28th. Be with us and help us to recognize what you are calling us to do and what decisions we need to make in order to make that possible. Lord, we pray for our community around us. We pray that we as a congregation may be a shining light in this community, but we pray for your blessing over this community in all other areas as well. Help us to partner with other initiatives in the community that are doing your work and that are helping people with the challenges that they are facing. We pray for our city, as many people in our city are struggling to make ends meet and others are struggling to fight the virus. Be with everyone, whatever challenge that they may have in the city. We pray for our country. We pray for the challenges that lie ahead in the political realm and society as a whole. We pray that people may step up to the plate and take their positions of leadership seriously to serve the community, to serve our country. We pray that greed may not be able to have the last word, but rather that people are serving selflessly to help our country recover from the challenges that we've had in the last while. And whatever else we have on our hearts, we now say to you in silence. Thank you, Lord, that you hear our prayer. Amen. The Lord invites us to his holy supper. He wishes to bless us and strengthen us with bread and wine. He wishes to release us from all that holds us in bondage. He wishes to refresh us by giving us new life and new hope through his body and blood. Let us invite him to be our host by singing the chorus, "Create in me a clean heart, O God."
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. And cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me.
And now, in preparation for coming to the Lord's table, let us confess our sins to God. And we do so in silence. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. The Almighty God has given his Son Jesus Christ to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. By the power our Lord has given the Church, and by his authority, I therefore declare all your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. It is right and for our lasting good that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O God, our Creator, Redeemer, and Comforter, through Jesus Christ. You come to us to have fellowship with us. You give yourself as a gift to us. You give us your life. You release us from sin. You grant us salvation. Therefore, we adore and magnify your glorious name, and together we sing.
Holy, holy.
And now let us join in the prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat of this. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after the meal, gave thanks, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and drink of this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you all. Come, for everything is ready. Taste and see that the Lord is good. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Let us pray. We thank you, loving God, for having refreshed us with this, your gift of bread and wine. We pray, let the sacrament strengthen us in faith and enable us to love and serve one another according to your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Saviour, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, now and always. Amen. And now go in the peace of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Thank you.